How's it going, you guys? Joe Watermelon here. Today, I'm going to help you guys complete the Grandmaster speedrun time for the four-man Theater of Blood. Now, it's important to note that this is not going to be a full guide, and of course, there are hundreds of different ways to achieve this speedrun. But more so, this will be a playthrough of me helping some friends with the Grandmaster speed combat achievements, along with some brief explanations as to what's going on and how to replicate it. I wanted this guide to be fairly Iron Man friendly, and also to not require an insane amount of Theater of Blood knowledge. So this is going to be a fairly simple method that doesn't require getting one down bloats, via Phoenix necklaces, or doing any kind of Sodaseg maze skipping shenanigans. To be clear, there are always tons of things that my friends and I could be doing better in runs like this. But if anything, I felt like that put me in the perfect position to help all you people out there that might not know all these insane TOB strategies. More or less, we're just going to be doing the raid with an emphasis on not losing ticks and good, but not too difficult of strategies. Now let's look at some of the suggested inventories. Note that while it might not be 100% efficient, it's okay if people swap some of these items around. If you're doing this task with one or more irons, there's a good chance that not everyone will have the required gear for their role. So feel free to switch some items around and downgrade as needed. First, we'll look at the mage role's inventory and setup. In a four-man TOB, you'll have two people freezing crabs at Maiden, but only one of them will be maging at Nylos, while the other one melees. So this is the setup for the dedicated mage. Something you'll notice in all the setups is that any completed godbook is required. This is one of the most important items in the whole method, so make sure everyone brings it. Next, you'll see the Tonsaltics of Ralos equipped, which will be used exclusively for Maiden defense lowering. Other than that, you'll just be wearing the normal ranged Elite Void with no quiver, unless you're an Iron who really cares about losing some arrows. Now onto the inventory. They're all pretty standard items. One thing, however, is that it's very important the mage roll and hopefully the melee freeze roll bring their Bandos God Swords along with the Elder Maul or Dragon Warhammer. You'll also notice the Bellator Ring switch for if you don't hit hammers at Sodaseg, but mainly it's for phase 2 of Verzik. Also, it's important to note that if you are a main, you'll be getting your ranged potion pot shared to you at the beginning of Nylos, as well as when the Nylo boss spawns. So you can replace that ranged pot with another angler or a super restore. Another commonly forgotten item is the blowpipe. Every single role should be bringing the blowpipe for the extra efficiency at Nylos, as well as the venom capability for the purple crab at Verzik. And finally, make sure you don't forget your imbued heart, as that will give you a couple max hits in the Nylo room. Now onto the melee freeze roll, or M freeze for short. You'll notice the equipped items are identical to the mage setup, and the only difference in the inventory here is instead of the imbued heart, you'll either bring the swift blade or the dual Macquitos for the Nylo room. Now for the ranger roll. For this roll, you'll be bringing quiver, which will contain the ruby bolts E for your Zerite crossbow. Equipped, you'll also have 25 black chinchampas roughly, which will be for the maiden stack, as well as 6 sets of double Nylo spawns in the Nylo's room. As for the ranger inventory, you'll see most of the things we discussed before, but this time no BGS and no mage gear other than the Sang, but instead the Zerite crossbow and runes for Venge, Pot Share, Spellbook Swap, and Thralls. The exact runes are Law, Water, Astral, Lava, Blood, Death, and Cosmic. Now for the last roll, the melee DPS. Here you'll want the standard max melee, as well as the god book that we had already talked about. As for the inventory, we've got mostly the same stuff as the ranger roll. However, you'll be taking a Din's Bulwark, which is crucial for Maiden, and then you'll be switching out the water runes for soul runes, which will allow you to cast Death Charge. And again, if you're an Iron, you should be bringing your own ranged pot instead of an angler. One last note is that if you're wondering why this setup should bring so much food, it is a massive time save at Sodaseg to take as many Venges as possible and then heal up during the maze portion when you can't lose ticks. Now let's get into the actual raid itself. Just to restate, this is going to be half playthrough and half guide, as I don't think it's necessary to explain every single thing going on. And very quickly before we get started, here's a couple of plugins that I think are very helpful. First, Tob QOL. Second, Nilo Death Indicators. Third, Party. Fourth, Party Defense Tracker. Fifth, Hub Party Panel. And finally, sixth, Niloer. Now, like every Theater of Blood, we start with Maiden. Also remember that the normal Tob speed times are room times only, meaning time spent in between the rooms or at the supply chests does not matter. The main strategy you'll see here is a variation of stacking crabs called cross-stacking. Now, I actually already have a short guide on YouTube of how cross-stacking differs from normal stacking, although normal stacking will be just fine as well. I'll leave a link in the description if you want to see the full guide for cross-stacking. First, we enter Maiden, and if both freezers have a Tanzaltix of Ralos, they'll both send one spec each. Then the mage will send a second spec, while the M freeze will save his second for the 30 skip. Or in our case, for the Din spec, because our MDPS did not have one. Only 6 Ralos hits, or 3 throws, are needed for 0 defense. Just to briefly explain stacking, we're getting the first 2 sets of crabs, the ones that come out at 70% Maiden HP and 50%, to be frozen on top of each other, which makes the Ice Barrages and Black Chins do much more damage per cast or throw. Also, the reason that you'll see the mages be max distance using the T-bow instead of Scythe is actually because of the amount of time each arrow takes to reach Maiden. It will make it so that even if it's your T-bow hit that procs a set of crabs, you'll still have time to freeze your first crab without being late at all. Basically, it means that you can keep attacking right up until crabs come out, which would not be the case if using Scythe. With the goal being to proc 50s crabs as soon as you can after 70s, the Ranger will do 3 Scythes as soon as 70s proc, followed by a Zerite crossbow spec. If no ZCB, then he can double claw instead. The melee DPS can then choose to either do 1 claw spec during that time, or save both of his specs for Dins. Once both sets of crabs are out and frozen, the melee DPS will then send 1 to 2 Dins Bulwark specs, which will hit the entire clump, as well as North 1s and 2s if cross stacking. Once the 70s and 50s are dead, everyone will get back on Maiden to proc the last set of crabs. The mages will then freeze these crabs, and then everyone will jump back on Maiden to attempt to kill her before the crabs become unfrozen. This is usually referred to as a 30s skip. If the M freeze still had a spec, he would claw here, and everyone else would attempt to do their last hit with the Crystal Halberd spec if they have it. Also, to make sure that you get the 30 skip, when the mages come up to scythe the boss, make sure to venge one of them and let them take that venge off prayer. Now we're on to Bloat. To start, it's not 100% necessary, but if someone knows how to do the pre-BGS, it does help. And again, this guide will not feature using Phoenix Necklaces to get a 1 down bloat, which on average will save you about 30 seconds minimum. That tech is not very Iron Man friendly, and a lot of people don't know how to do it, so again, we're gonna not include it, and just do bloat normally and get a 2 down. Once bloat goes down, everyone will do 1 Chally spec, followed by 4 Scythe hits, and then 1 more Chally spec. This part is very important. I still see plenty of people with high Tob KCs that don't do that 4th Scythe, just so that they don't take some extra stomp damage. If bloat is in a flinchable spot, you can actually do all the hits without taking the stomp, as seen here.
That session was like 10 seconds away from that. We still got pretty close.
Alright, you're on tick to do it, Lewis. So that was your first Scythe. After 4, that was your second. After 4, go here and equip challenge. That's 3. 4. Beautiful.
Longbone.
Some people in the clan are doing real gaming right now.
I was probably on DMM, huh?
When bloat goes down for a second time, everyone will use their 1 claw spec and scythe the rest until he's dead. Next, we're on to Nilo. Firstly, I'm going to share a little bit about the plugins I had you guys get earlier and tell you what they do. Nilo death animations will instantly show whether you or a team member has killed a Nilo by immediately turning it invisible. This takes care of wasting hits, especially in the mage role, on a Nilo that is already dead. Secondly, the Niloer plugin can show you what waves you're on by attaching the wave number to each Nilo that spawns. Not only does this help to start learning what spawns when, but it also helps to show you which Nilo you should kill, because the higher the number, the more recent the wave. Now onto the room itself. This is a room that has a massive skill ceiling, and I personally still have a ton to learn. But other than learning your pre-fires and wave specifics, here are some general tips that should help. 1. Always kill the newest Nilos, which usually means the ones coming down the lanes. This is because every Nilo is on a timer as soon as it spawns, where it'll eventually explode by itself, so it's better to kill newer Nilos than ones that might die by itself sooner. 2. If you notice a stall, which is when no new Nilos are spawning, focus on killing these small Nilos instead of the big ones. 3. Make sure that if you don't have any crabs of your style to kill, you're always switching weapons and killing some other ones of other styles. This is where that blowpipe comes in very handy. And finally, 4. Make sure that once the waves are finishing up, everyone is helping to clean up all of the crabs still alive. And make sure that all the big Nilos are dead, or else you might find yourself waiting for the two Nilo splits to spawn from the big. This cleanup phase is usually where I see a lot of people standing around and where I see a lot of time wasted.
We didn't stall there, did we?
No. Focus smalls. Can't hit this big mage over here, Previn. There's so many mages and none of them are next to each other. When the Nilo boss spawns, make sure that one person is using BGS on it. If the first BGS spec hits somewhere under 25, I'd re-BGS. Everyone else will do a claw spec into a Chally spec. If the ranger has his ECB, he can use that as a spec instead. Make sure that once the boss is under 30%, the next melee phase will have everyone doing one scythe into a Chally spec in hopes that they kill it. Also remember that every time a mage phase happens, the next ranged phase, you'll be able to get a blowpipe in between your Tebow hits. Also take as many venges off prayer as you can without risking dying.
Chally, if it's melee phase next, scythe then Chally.
Nice, not bad.
Hey, how do
nice, that's really good. 357, hell yeah.
After the Nilo room has been completed, it's time for Soda Seg.
Are you
This room will prove to be pretty simple compared to others, but can also easily kill a run due to complete RNG. You probably already know that in all three separate phases of Sotaseg, you want two Elder Maul or two Dragon Warhammer specs to hit. Hitting more than this in one phase will do absolutely nothing, as Sotaseg's defense can only be lowered to 100. The spec order is usually determined by rolls, with my team doing the following. North Mage hammers first and second phase. Melee Freeze hammers first and third phase. The Ranger hammers second and third phase. And the melee DPS is a backup. Because these rolls and spec timings work out so perfectly, please do not make the mistake of thinking that Lightbearer is a good choice in this room, and stick with your Altor, Bellator, or Berserker rings. Other than hoping your specs land here, the method for any player with Vengeance is to tank as many off-prayer orbs as you can without chancing dying. After each phase, you use the maze to eat any remaining sharks or anglers to make sure you can continue venging next phase as well. If you're still struggling getting tick perfect mazes, I'll link a maze trainer down below that really helped me.
Hit. Your bench, Brevin.
I'll take one in a second.
Mage ball coming at you.
Scary. Another good venge.
Right-ish. Here we go.
That is the definition of right-ish.
That's a right six for me, brother. You got that all marked now.
Hits.
Hit.
Beautiful. Cool call once.
Ooh, that was a big ass claw.
Chowing.
Zero, oh, big zero. Ass Chowy.
I hit a zero. I hit a zero. That is so
I hit a 47-48.
Now, before going into Zarpist, you'll have the last supply chest to buy from. Because we'll be god booking P1 of Verzik, it is critical that you have a minimum of 3 brews and 2 restores. If worse comes to worse, you can hope that 2 brews will be enough. And remember, if you don't have a defender, you can equip your staff and your god book to free up 1 extra inventory space. And because we won't be running for P1 Verzik, and Verzik should be dying pretty quickly into P3, there is no need for staminas. And now we're on to Zarpus. For Zarpus, there are 3 phases. During the first exhumed phase, in a 4-man team, you're each going to want to stay in your quadrant and only cover for your teammate if the exhumed isn't too far away from your own space.
Trying to figure something out. I accidentally came in here with a 3-dose super combat, so I'm going to eat that instead of an angler and then grab staff.
I mean, I can grab staff if you don't want to sink that.
No, I have to, because I'm eating.
Wait, I have an angler. I can grab staff.
No. I'm eating it. This is my
last one. When phase 2 starts, you'll want 3 people to hammer or Elder Maul on tick 1, 1 person to BGS on tick 2, and then if needed, both people with a BGS can spec again. Again, this is where having that party defense tracker comes in very handy. If it's 0 defense, anyone with remaining spec can claw. And now obviously if you know how to 5 tick with Scythe, you'll do that for P2. But if not, 5.3 tick, or normal melee Zarpus, should be just fine as well. Also, if you've ever wanted to learn stuff like 5 tick Zarpus or more advanced top strategies, stay tuned for the next video I'll be releasing.
Really fucking well with the Scythe right now though. I genuinely haven't hit under a 60 yet.
I've been hitting a lot too.
During the last phase after Zarpus screeches, I still see so many people lose ticks with Scythe. The cycle for how many Scythe hits you do for every Zarpus turn is as follows. 2 hits, 2 hits, 1 hit, 2 hits, 1 hit, and repeating. The difficulty is knowing where in that cycle you're starting. Once Zarpus is dead, it's time for the final boss, Verzik Vatur. The one big difference between Verzik and normal Tobbs, and Verzik doing a speedrun, is the god booking method for P1. Now I know this will sound confusing, I know it'll sound complicated, but it really ends up being one of the easiest ways to do P1 and a massive time save. To sum this god booking method up, before the fight starts, each player will preach with the god book, which uses special attack. We'll then time the room starting with when we get our spec back, so that instead of only being able to do 2 Dawnbringer specs in a row, every player will be able to do 3 in a row. To avoid losing ticks, instead of hiding behind the pillar when Verzik attacks, everyone will be standing still, face tanking her while we drop Dawnbringer and continue to Scythe. This is where having those brews comes in handy, as any time you lose HP, you'll be chugging brews without worrying about your boosted stats at all. The only time you'd ever want to hide behind the pillar is if you can't heal above 60 for one of her attacks, but realistically that should never happen. As for the specifics of god booking, I'll put them up on screen, and also have them linked down below if you and your friends want to study them. To begin, every player needs to make sure they have the god book plugin installed and turned on, with the tick set to the default of 157. To then get started, player 1/mage roll will preach. Player 2/mfreeze will preach when player 1's timer says 13. Player 3/theranger will preach when player 1's timer says 26, and finally player 4 or melee DPS will preach when the original timer says 39. Now that everyone's special attack will be regenning at the right time, everyone will stand by Verzik and summon thralls/turn mage prayer on once the original timer gets to around 125. On tick 149, the mage, or player 1, will start the room and immediately use 3 Dawnbringer specs. After the specs have been used, he'll drop the staff, and everyone in the party will follow suit with 3 specs all back to back. Here's a breakdown of the attacks broken down by ticks that everyone will do to make sure that they're picking up staff as soon as it's dropped. The D stands for Dawnbringer, the S stands for Scythe, the B stands for Swiftblade, and C stands for Claw Scratch. And the red boxes are when Verzik is using a mage attack. Now while attacking Verzik, make sure you are brewing up any time you can gain HP from it. Having boosted super combat stats do not matter for this phase, as Dawnbringer is doing the majority of the damage. Also, if your roll says to Swiftblade somewhere, and then Scythe, instead you can do 2 4 tick hits.
And a terrible P1.
If you guys haven't yet.
Available, by the way.
Yep, and if you haven't, so you can spellbook swap right now.
Already have.
We're starting at 149. Chug brews. Basically, if you have the health that a brew can heal, just eat it anyways. Mage prayer on. There we go. Once phase 1 of Verzik is dead, it's time to start phase 2. The biggest things to remember about this phase is to try not to lose ticks when the exploding Nylos spawn, do Boak if you know it,
and that you only want to get one red crab phase, as getting another is a massive time loss.
You're getting so unlucky with who those crabs are on, Swap.
Yeah.
Chat, if this ends up being like 4 seconds off or less, it's my fault for forgetting the super combo thing, because I'm not going to have a divine soon.
Dragon Claw spec spent ensuring only one set of red crabs happens is much more efficient than using claws anywhere else in the room.
Come on.
That's come on, bro.
Air. So I hit 70. It's okay. We're skipping, remember? If you have a claw, you should do it.
Where did we hit this one?
Like Charlie's, but no, we don't need to, right?
If you have a claw, do a claw, don't do a Charlie, though. Come on. Oh, nice. Oh, thank God.
Now phase 3 starts. There isn't too much going on this phase. You want to tank off Prayer Venges, you want to try not to lose any ticks, and you want to try not to move the boss at all if tanking. However, there is one extra tip for how to restore hit points without ever being brewed down. Basically, right when you swing your scythe, you click your brew, and then right before your next scythe, you click your super combat. Doing this will give you HP back without ever being brewed down for any hits. You can also do a slightly less efficient version of this if you need to heal more, by doing 2 brew sips after the first scythe, and then 1 super restore and 1 super combat before your second scythe. Both of these options, however, are much more efficient than the traditional 3 brew to 1 super restore to 1 super combat method. The last piece of advice I have is that if your tank knows how to pog tank, I'd highly recommend them doing that out of webs, as it's much easier to dodge purple tornadoes if Verzik is standing still.
We're running to that Tywai mark. It's later than you think. Way, way, way too early. Like 20 ticks too early. Nice, good though. One crab's on you, Swap. Live. Crab's on you. North if you haven't. Mm-hmm. Revan, you're gonna have to scythe and then step under for pog tank.
Cheesy.
Is that it?
Yeah,
woo!
Beautiful.
Hell yeah. Very nice.
Peace. One and done.
One and done. Rewarded!
Nice try.
You dickhead, you actually fucking got me.
Once Verzik is dead, you'll hopefully be one Grandmaster task closer to that Zuck Helm. As always, I really hope you guys enjoyed the video, and if you did, be sure to leave a sub, like, and comment. I'll also leave the link to my Twitch in the video description. If you'd like to watch me live, I stream just about every single day, streaming endgame iron content. And stay tuned for our upcoming video, Tob Advanced Tips and Tricks. Take it easy, everyone, and I'll see you next time.